Hello, everybody. Welcome. Well, yeah, good evening, and welcome to CPAWS speaker series. We're working to look at sustainable change for the Yukon. I'm Jill Cracknell, and I'm the executive director of CPAWS Yukon. And I'd like to welcome you. Thank you so much for coming out tonight. And we created this series because we want to engage Yukoners in a positive debate about our future and to hear different perspectives on the issues that face us and what we might be able to do about them. And I want you to put this in your diary for November. We've got Zipporah Berman coming up on the 17th of November. She'll be speaking here at Beringia. That's a Monday night. And she's well known for her campaigning. And at this point in time, she's focusing on carbon and Canada's energy future, the landscape of energy in Canada. So that'll be an exciting talk. I'd also like to flag for you the Peel hearing, which is a week tomorrow, Friday, in the courthouse in Whitehorse. We have Tom Berger coming back up to argue for further argument of the remedies that were proposed in July. And of course, John Hunter will be there for the government. And so the public is welcome. We heard today that there will be two courtrooms again, as there were in July. There'll be live video stream into the second courtroom. So I encourage you all to come out. Court starts at 10 o'clock, so that's October 24th, next Friday, a week tomorrow. And tonight, I'm very excited to introduce our speaker tonight. I often find when we're discussing our future, we kind of divide it up. We divide it into the economy and the environment and health and well-being. And really, you know, that's not how it is. It's all connected, it's all interdependent. And our speaker tonight is a master of the art of putting that all together, looking at the big picture. And he has the best credentials I can think of for looking at all the different pieces, the finance, the economics, the environment. He has a master's of finance from Chicago. He has a PhD in natural resources from University of Vermont. He was president of Sanctuary Asset Management and vice president of Salomon Brothers and Lehman Brothers. He's currently on the boards of the Post Carbon Institute, of Bottleneck Foundation, IIER, and the Institute for the Study of Energy and the Future. And of course, he's well known for his work as editor of the Oil Drum, which he did until a couple of years ago. So I'd like you all to give a huge welcome to our guest speaker tonight, all the way from Wisconsin in the USA. Please welcome Nate Hagens, Dr. Nate Hagens.
Thank you. Very happy to be here. Before I start the slideshow, maybe I'll tell you why I'm here. So as Jill said, I worked on Wall Street for a while. I used to manage money for billionaires. That was my job out of graduate school. I would cold call someone that had $100 million. If they had $95 million, I was not allowed to call them. And I learned at a very young age that people that had $300 million said they'd get to $500 million and they'd quit. But they didn't quit because when they got to $500 million, their buddies had $800 million. And it wasn't about dollars didn't make them happier. It was a game. And I was 26 or 27 and making a lot of money. And you know, when I was 28, I made $500,000. And at the end of the year, I spent it all. I did not have a penny left. So I wasn't the wolf on Wall Street, but I was kind of the coyote or something. And I did that sort of thing. And it never really sat well with me. And I started to read books about the environment. And the first epiphany I had was that the externalities, the costs that are not included in the price that we pay for things, are part of the commons and not part of the market system, and that didn't seem right to me. And I started reading books on like Ishmael and the End of Nature and The Last Hours of Ancient Sunlight, and I realized that these issues of energy depletion and environmental health and human population and all this is happening during my life, and I felt like what I was doing was empty. And so I quit, and I actually hiked almost up to the Yukon. I went all the way through British Columbia to Alaska with my dog and a bag full of books, Herman Daly ecology books on the world. And pretty much for the last 12 years, I've been learning how to explain the human ecosystem, how all of it fits together. And I sit on various environmental boards. And Jill called me a few months ago and asked if I would come up here, and I said no. This is actually the first talk I've given in 3 years outside of my home state. But then we started talking about it, and I think the Yukon has got such a special situation. You're going to be in the crosshairs of the energy and climate debate. You've got a low population density. You have huge natural capital, and you also have low political thresholds because there's so few people. And so I thought I'd come here to explain how this all fits together and what kind of some likely futures are and how Yukoners can maybe play a role and make this not only better, but maybe possibly as a beacon to the rest of the world with your examples. So having said all that, I'm going to have, I gave a similar talk 2 nights ago in Vancouver on my way here. And I set an all-time record with 213 slides, and Jill's like, that's too many. And so I removed 17 slides. And then this afternoon, I added back 18. So this will be a new record, but I will speak relatively fast, and I'm gonna cover a lot. Don't try to remember everything. Just kind of get like a texture of what I'm saying. So we watch TV, and we look at the news every day, and we're bombarded with opinions on this and very charismatic people saying this is to blame and this is what's going on. And I've come to view the world through various lenses. And the lenses that I think are most important are energy, the environment, and behavior. And I'm going to talk a little bit about each of those. And related to energy is money, because you can't understand energy unless you understand money. So first, let's start with energy. So energy is the fundamental building block of nature. At every level of the trophic pyramid in nature, there's an energy conversion. The sun shines on the plants, the herbivores eat the plants, the carnivores eat the herbivores, and at every level there's an energy exchange and some heat loss. But underpinning it all is the sun and energy. And this translates not only in nature but into the human sphere. And our economy uses ancient sunlight in the form of fossil carbon, old sunlight in the form of timber and trees, and current sunlight, which is animal power and crops. This is a graph of the energy composition of North America the last 200 years. And you can see not that long ago, less than 200 years ago, the vast majority of our energy use was wood and animal feed. In the 1920s, in the 1910 to 20, fully 30% of the agricultural land of the United States was dedicated towards feed for horses. And then, of course, we found fossil carbon and had a big uptick in coal and then oil and then gas. And so our wood use for fuel is very small relative to where it used to be. So this energy comes into the human system, and since fossil fuels are so powerful, I'm going to talk about that. The benefits that we get, and I'm going to use the word benefits many times tonight, but benefits really is some combination of higher wages or any wages, profits, reduced price of stuff, and or more people. 50% of the proteins in our bodies and 80% of the nitrogen in our bodies is directly from the Haber-Bosch process, using nitrogen from natural gas to grow food. So 150 years ago, people were made of sunlight. Really, we're not fully made of sunlight. So this is a correlation graph showing how correlated energy use is with GDP, which is gross domestic product, which is how much our economies are. And the red line is GDP, and the other lines are various energy measures. The most useful energy, which we can target to what we need to produce or use or want, is electricity. And the correlation between electricity and GDP is extremely high. And you might ask, well, how do you know which one is causing the other? And in some sense, it doesn't matter. Think about a factory. If you have a factory and you want to make 100 additional units than you did last year, you're going to need more energy input for each of those units. So the common economist's comeback is, well, so what if we have less energy? We can just use something else. We'll use some other input. I didn't know too many famous people in Canada that you would recognize, so I just used him. I thought Geddy Lee wouldn't make the point real well. But that's not right, because every single thing we do in our economy that generates goods and services first requires an energy conversion, an energy input. No matter how we make a cup, whether it's with plastic or with glass or with coconut or with clay, we need to put energy in first. So energy is special. How special? Everything on this graph costs around $90. Boots or a coffee machine or some food. But oil, one barrel of oil, which costs around $90 now, has 5.7 million BTUs of energy potential in it. How much is that? Well, that translates into 1,700 kilowatt hours of work potential. Well, how much is that? Well, you all, shoveling snow or backpacking and doing work or carrying timber or any physical labor, do around 6/10 of 1 kilowatt hour in one workday. So one barrel of fossil sunlight compressed over 200 million years ago replaces 11 years of me working. The average American salary is $44,000 a year. So one barrel of oil, which we pay less than $100 for, because all the work in condensing it and enriching it already happened by geology, subsidizes, supplants, substitutes $500,000 of American human labor, similar for Canada. So if you consider that we have these energy slaves, the average human in the United States costs $260 a kilowatt hour to do work, versus, you can see down the left-hand column, those are the various prices. Electricity from natural gas, 6 cents. So $260 versus 6 cents. The middle column is how many slaves that we are, or how many human helpers we're getting from that incredibly powerful, energy-dense stuff that we pulled out of the ground. Americans are wealthier than most countries, so we use around 4 to 5 times as much energy as the average human. So, but the same principle applies. Economists will say, but labor and capital are the main drivers of economic growth, with some little productivity magic factor in there. But the truth is that labor and capital are dependent variables on energy. Energy is what drives the wealth and productivity of our economies. I don't know exactly in Canada, but it's close. It's actually higher than America. We use around 60 barrel of oil equivalents of coal oil and natural gas every year per person. So we have hundreds and hundreds of unseen fossil slaves walking behind us. They don't complain. We don't even know they're there. We're discovering that they poop and they breathe, which I've seen some of your climate literature here. We know that that is a problem. So here's a picture of me. I'm like 1/10 of a horse. That's one of my horses, which is one horse. That's my utility vehicle, 45 horsepower, and my truck, which is 150 horsepower. So this amount of diesel fuel will power that 3,000-pound truck full of logs and stuff 6 or 7 miles down the road. And imagine a human doing the same thing, or 50 humans up and down snowy hills. It's amazingly powerful. Okay, so let me relate that to an example. What we've done is used huge amounts of fossil energy to replace things that humans used to do. We've done that at an energy inefficient way. Now imagine a lumberjack who's trying to chop firewood with an axe. And he does it and he ends up getting $5 an hour. Okay, so his buddy comes along and now they can lift larger logs together. And the two of them together can make $15 an hour, divided by two is $7.50, kind of a comparative advantage. But then we add mechanical energy and they build a road made from asphalt, made from fossil fuels. And the road enables them to like have an easy access to their market, and all of a sudden we add 50 units of fossil labor to the equation, and the wage goes to $15. And then we add chainsaws versus axes, and that's another 50 units, so we have 100 units of fossil labor, and the wage, or alternatively the profit for the owners of the capital, or alternatively you could really reduce the price of the firewood, or some combination of the three, goes up to $25 an hour. And then we add a truck that can haul the wood to be split later. And that is more units of energy, but the wage goes up very high, $50 an hour. And then we add this fancy machine, which is more mechanical units of energy, 400 units in total, and our wages are above $50 an hour. So what happens when oil or when gasoline goes from $2 to $4 a gallon is our benefits, our wages go down quite a bit. Well, it only went up from $2 to $4 and it's so powerful. Why would the benefits go down that much? And the answer is because we use so many units of energy in these processes. Well, what happens when $4 gasoline goes to $6? The benefits go down even more. And what's interesting here is that the operations that use slightly less energy than the most energy intense now are more profitable because we have so many energy units built into some of these processes. So this is what's happened to the world the last 30 or 40 years, is economies used to be more local and regional, and now we've outsourced because oil as a transportation fuel was so cheap that we could ship things all around the world in these complex supply chains. And now we have global supply chains that are dependent on this cheap petroleum. And with the exception of the last month, we've had year-over-year increases, which I'll get into in a minute. But we have globally connected supply chains now. When Fukushima happened, 10 days later, they had to stop making black trucks in Detroit because the pigment that was made in Fukushima was the only black pigment for trucks in the whole world, examples like that. So the narrative is that there's plenty of energy, and the United States is about to be the Saudi Arabia of energy, and Canada has 100 years of tar sands, et cetera. This is all technically true, but there's an asterisk, an important one. And the asterisk is there's a conflation between energy resources and energy reserves. Energy reserves are how much we can afford to get out of the ground, how much resources, how much like hydrocarbon molecules we've found. So it's a difference from looking at a huge herd of buffalo versus from a lion or cheetah's perspective versus the ones that are easier to get. This chart here shows the break-even all-in cost for oil majors for including capital expenditures and dividends. 1999 or the year 2000 it was $9 a barrel, and 2014 it's $120 a barrel, which includes the capital expenditures. So forget about what the price is at the pump. This is what the major oil companies in the world, this is what it's costing them to extract it. So as you know, with the benefits I just described, as oil extraction costs go up, the benefits decline. This is quickly three of the largest oil companies in the world. The orange lines are their capital expenditures to find oil, and the blue lines are their production the last 3 years, or 4 years. So there's another common theme that technology will be able to solve these problems. Let me speak to that a little bit. So this is what I wrote my PhD on, a concept called net energy, which is how much energy or other natural resources it takes to get energy. Not how many dollars, but how much energy. And in nature, this is based on something called optimal foraging theory, which is if a cheetah doesn't get enough calories in the prey that he chases, there won't be enough leftover surplus energy for cellular maintenance, metabolism, mating, reproduction, etc. If a cheetah would chase a mouse all day, he would have 100% success rate, but he'd be expending more calories than he was getting in the mouse. The same thing is happening in the human sphere. 70, 80 years ago, we had the Beverly Hillbilly oil that was right underneath the surface. It only would take one barrel of oil to get out 100 or more. And then the 1970s or so, we started to look offshore and we built these big rigs that had to drill 5,000 feet under. And now we're going to the more unconventional fuels, which there's plenty of, but they have environmental costs and they actually have energy costs and water costs. So that's kind of the trajectory that we're on. This is quickly a chart showing the energy return on investment. So how much energy we got back for the energy we input from finding oil. And it used to be over 1,200 to 1, and the last 40 years have blown up in the upper right there. It's in the single digits now. So if you look at the whole economy from a biophysical perspective, how much surplus does the global economy have from an energy perspective? We used to have 50 to 1 or 60 to 1. Some of the old legacy hydro power stations are 100 to 1. And then we kind of went down to the 20 to 1 or so, and I would argue we're in the mid-teens right now. And what does that mean? If you're at 20 to 1, that means a society is spending 5% of its energy in the energy sector. 95% gets to go to other activities. I think we're headed for 5% to 10% or 15% of our economies are going to be directed toward the energy sector, and that has implications. So standard economists will tell you that the blue line is what holds, that things get cheaper over time, we get better with technology, and like toasters or refrigerators get cheaper over time. But energy is finite. We're getting the best stuff first, the middle stuff second, and we're kind of working our way through that middle tranche, and it's more like a bathtub shape. It gets more expensive over time. I'm about to segue into money. This is a chart. The blue line shows the Canadian dollar, and the red line shows oil prices up until last week, and you can see that the Canadian economy, your largest export is oil, so it's going to be very correlated with oil prices. You might think, well, look at now, oil's down to $80. That's good news, right? You said the benefits would be better if the oil price is lower. Yes, but looking at the oil price itself is looking at the car ahead of you in a snowstorm. Looking at the extraction costs from the oil company's perspective is looking two cars ahead. And looking at the EROI, or the biophysical cost, is like looking at a weather report before you go outside. And the problem of $80 oil is it's approaching the break-even cost for a lot of the Bakken shale and some of these places. And they can't make money at $80, so they're going to stop drilling, which then what happens? Wells are depleting so fast that a year from now, the depletion is going to be so much that the prices are going to skyrocket again. And those little windows are going to be shorter and more volatile. Okay, so how does technology relate to energy? Another fundamental misunderstanding in my experience. I think there are four ways that we use technology. The main way is to replace what humans used to do with mechanical fossil labor, like chainsaws or driving a car instead of walking. Another way is we've developed new ways to use energy, like Facebook, et cetera. Around 13% of our electricity in North America goes to server farms for the internet. And 10% of internet traffic is related to cats. So 3% of our energy is, I'm not sure that is exactly true. But a third way is we make our things better or more efficient. We make power plants use the coal or whatever it is. More energy per use. And then the fourth thing would we develop new technologies to find energy or to use solar panels or geothermal or things like that. So all four of these are ways that we use technology, but the first two dominate. And for the most part, all technology is a vector that increases the size of our energy metabolism globally. So real quickly, this is an aggregate graph. The beige On the bottom is biomass or trees or timber. The green is oil. The red is natural gas. The gray is coal. A light blue is nuclear. Dark blue is hydro. And the little light yellow on the top is renewables. No matter what has happened in the past, we've managed to continue to increase aggregate energy, gross aggregate energy. So again, we think about these time-saving devices like a lawnmower or Facebook. I did this great thing in Vancouver two nights ago. They have this thing called Car to Go. And you can just like find a car that's laying around and no one's using it, and you put your credit card in, you can drive where you want to go. Great time-saving device. But what did I do? I got to where I was going a half hour earlier, and I just got on Facebook and just doodled around. So we kind of waste some of this time savings on things that maybe not are the most appropriate. So energy prices are going up. You all know that. I'm going to talk a little bit about that later. Here's another unexpected implication of these fossil slaves and the fossil mechanized labor, is that they've been so cheap that in some cases, especially if business and industry is cutting corners and trying to maximize profits, it's cheaper for them to hire robots and mechanical things than real people. And that has an implication here. In the United States, real wages adjusted for inflation peaked 40 years ago, the gray line, and productivity has continued up. So I think this is one of the explanations for that is, I don't want to hire these people and pay them $20 an hour because I can have this equipment do it for $3. Okay, moving on to money. So what is money? Given I just told you that energy underpins our economies, money is a claim on future energy. Now that future energy might be tomorrow morning or tonight at the bar or breakfast, or this weekend you buy something, or it might be something that you have your bank account in digital electronic money and spend it 10 years from now or 20 years from now. But it is a claim. As soon as the money is spent, it's spent on, it draws energy and resource conversions. So financial capital is really just a marker for real capital. What is real capital? From an ecological economics perspective, it's natural capital, which is, this is my backyard, which is fresh water, healthy soil, and trees, and healthy ecosystems. There's social capital, which is our networks, our friends, our family, our relationships. In this case, my dogs, who I miss terribly, by the way. There's built capital, which this is our house, solar panels on the top, there's some chainsaws, there's a barbecue grill, there's an aloe vera plant, etc. These are ways that we transformed primary natural resources into secondary natural resources that humans use. And then finally, there's human capital, which is our skills, our knowledge, our health, etc. This is me identifying an edible mushroom. And that's my dad. He's a surgeon, and he knows how to grow vegetables. So, but he hates doing it. He complains. So financial capital is a marker for all those things. And when we left hunter-gatherer stage and went to the agricultural revolution 12,000 years ago, we started to subsume away the needs and wants of the individual, and instead we started to optimize for the larger human society, and we optimized for surplus. The agricultural surplus allowed us to pay other people in corn or whatever it is. And now, fast forward to now, and we're optimizing what? We're optimizing surplus value. We're optimizing stocks and bonds and other financial markers. Okay, so how does money come into existence? The textbooks are actually wrong on that. They treat banks as financial intermediaries. The truth is something different. Imagine that Jill wanted to get a $200,000 loan for some business here in Whitehorse. She goes to the bank, and the banks here, the commercial banks in Canada, are the same as the United States, and the same in Europe, and the same in the UK. Slightly different in China, but pretty much the world over. If her credit rating is good, the bank will put $200,000 into her account. At the same time, a $200,000 IOU asset goes on the bank ledger. So from the bank's perspective, everything is balanced. Jill could spend that money that instant on anything she wanted. But here's the secret, or the scary thing, is at that moment, nowhere in the world, nowhere in Yukon, nowhere in Canada, did $200,000 of purchasing power leave. So at that moment, we grew the amount of financial claims we had on future energy, but we didn't do anything with the energy. Now, until 1971, this wasn't the case. There was a gold standard. Things were tethered to some natural resource. Now, gold isn't worth as much as oil, but it takes some oil to get gold, at least. So every year since I've been on the planet, we in America, and I'm not real versed in the Canadian situation, but it's generally similar, have grown our debt more than we've grown our GDP every single year. So if you, debt does not have to be a bad thing. If you have a great idea and you grow a business and you pay the debt back and then you make, create wealth, et cetera, it's fine. But when you borrow money and the, what you generate from it is less than you borrowed, that means that it's declining productivity. And the right curve shows the 40 years of debt productivity in the United States. If you add $1 trillion and you only add a couple hundred billion in GDP from that additional, you're not being real efficient. And once you get to zero, once you add $1 trillion of debt just to keep GDP flat, well, then what you're doing is you're transmuting wealth into income. And we're headed in that direction. All countries in the world are on this path. So if you think about what would happen, this is kind of instructive to maybe make you understand the relationship between energy and money. What would happen if some helicopters came over Whitehorse tomorrow and dropped $5 billion of Canadian cash? People would be, hey, Joe, come on out here. And you would be grabbing stuff in their backpacks full of money. Some people would have $1 million. Some people would have, well, actually, in the example I just said, everyone in Whitehorse would have $1 million or more. But a lot of people would be very wealthy all of a sudden. And some people that came late would have, you know, $500 or whatever. But what would happen is people would buy cars and trucks, and they would take vacations, and they would build houses. And at that moment, a lot more demand for oil and energy and minerals and resources would have happened. But what happened to the underlying energy? Nothing. There was no, so that's going to deplete further. Well, this example of this helicopter drop is exactly what the developed world has been doing since the financial collapse of 2008. This is a real picture of a helicopter dropping money in the Philippines, by the way. Okay, so there's two quick lenses for debt. One is debt is a zero-sum game in one sense. There's a creditor and there's a debtor. Someone gets richer, someone gets poorer. And so that explains wealth inequality is getting worse in Canada and in the US and in the world. But there's another lens, which is a little more sinister, and that is that all debt is relative. All money that comes into existence, 95% of the money that is created comes from commercial banks. And all the money in our systems is a claim on future energy and resources, and they are diverging. Okay. Moving on to my favorite topic is human behavior. And it's especially favorite now because I'm in Canada. So we evolved from apes, not the apes that are alive today, but apes that were alive 6 or 7 million years ago. And we share 98.9% of our genes with our closest cousins, chimpanzees. We share 90% with cows, 80% with cats, 70% with mice, 60% with fruit flies, 50% with bananas. We share genes with every living thing on the planet, and there's a reason for that, is because we all came down some evolutionary path. The main difference between chimpanzee and human DNA, since we've sequenced the genome now, is there's very few genetic differences. Some of them have to do with olfactory reception. And one of the other bizarre differences is the brains are not different. The genes for the brain are not different, but there's a gene for the protein coding of the in the uterus. The human spends three more times of cell division. So humans have three times the neurons of a chimpanzee just because of this extra cell division, because of a protein coding a gene. I'm diverging, but this is so important because to understand where we are in our global predicament, we have to understand where we came from. And the reason I'm happy that I'm in Canada is because most people here believe that we evolved. I could not do this part of the talk in some places in America, and it's embarrassing. Like, I have to get permission in some schools that I've given talks. And, you know, truly there are people I've come encountered that argue with me that we used to ride dinosaurs and such. So why is this all important? Well, it's important because the brain, the human brain, evolved in a period, a long, long period of scarcity and privation. And so things that were in short supply activated our and honed our circuitry towards the behaviors of our evolutionary past. And we have kind of three remnant areas of our brain. We have the reptilian brain, deep-seated from long ago. We have the mammalian brain on top of that, which is also called the limbic system, which deals with our emotions and such. And then we have the neocortex, which is up and forward, which is what makes humans sets us apart, and that's our thinking about our bills and what fishing lure to buy and our mortgage payments. And the idea is that if all three of these brain regions work together, we can accomplish amazing things. But sometimes one of the brain regions kind of scoots off and does its own thing. So right there, what happened is your reptilian brain, and I met you earlier tonight, so you know I'm not some crazy guy, but you knew your reptilian brain, your fight or flight, took over in that second, and it overran your rational thinking, and that happens a lot to us in all different situations. Okay, so getting more to the point, we have such a thing called a steep discount rate. So science has told us that we are impacting the biosphere with our carbon emissions. Actually, they're very certain that climate change is a dire problem and that humans are causing it. Actually, they're 95% certain that we have like 20 years to make some changes, otherwise something bad's gonna happen. And it's so dangerous that we have to leave the coal in the ground for hundreds of years. Otherwise, we're going to have massive heat waves and droughts and et cetera. And did you hear about that? No, maybe we should just go get a beer. That's not that concerning. Holy crap, Godzilla's in Whitehorse. And then, only when the monster is here, do we react. Because our brains evolve to care only about the present, and these long-term challenges that humans are facing right now are way in the distance, and we can think about them, and we can process them, and we can understand them, but we don't behaviorally react the way that our ancestors did, because they were very short-term risks. So that's something called a discount rate. A discount rate is a measure from 0 to 1, 1 being I care about only right now, 0 being a robot which cares about the year 2700, as long as there's electricity, as much as today. And a goldfish, if you feed him 3 days of food because you're going out of town for the weekend, he'll eat all of it until he blows up. So we can measure our preference for the future using something at a discount rate. And Americans and Canadians and Europeans and most in the developed world don't care about the future that much. The future is this weekend or maybe next month. You can imagine someone graduating college, high school, is not going to be thinking something like this. Okay, status, sexual selection. In nature, sexual selection is a large driver of animal behavior. Take, for example, a peacock. Uses up a lot of minerals and resources and bugs and seeds and energy to devote towards an ornate and showy tail. The ornate and showy tail then makes him more conspicuous to predators, and also if a predator sees him, it'll be harder for him to get away. All three of those negative biological fitness hits are outweighed by the preference of the female peahen for large, showy tails. This manifests in the human sphere in many, many ways, and you all laugh. Why? Because you know and you've experienced it yourself. Every year some billionaire wants to build my yacht 4 feet longer than the world's largest yacht, et cetera. So think about this hypothetical question. Would you rather a 4,000 square foot house, which is a pretty big house, but in a neighborhood of 6,000 square foot houses where all your neighbors' houses are bigger? Or would you prefer a 3,000 square foot house, a smaller house, but all your neighbors' houses are 2,000 square foot? The vast majority of people take a guess would prefer the smaller house as long as it's bigger than their neighbor's house. This is a fundamental problem of what we're facing right now, because it's not about absolute wealth. It's not about absolute wants and needs. It's relative to our perception of what other people have and what culture is telling us to pursue. So in nature, there are negative feedbacks to more and more consumption. If a lion eats his third gazelle of the day, it's going to get stuck in his gullet and he won't be able to physically eat it. If deer antlers get so unbelievably heavy and big, the deer will fall over and not be able to eat. In human systems, it's not that way. And I realize this on Wall Street, is we don't, there's positive feedbacks, not negative feedbacks. We consume because we can. And I also realized another quick anecdote that when I was 28, I was fielding phone calls from these super rich guys. And I have nothing against rich people. I'm just giving you an example that they would be calling me from the delivery room. Hey, yeah, where's IBM stock? And like their wife was giving birth and they were checking in on stock quotes. So that was a clue to me at the beginning. I'm like, wait a minute, something doesn't jive there. Okay, supernormal stimuli and addiction. So there's a field called ethology, which is the study of animal behavior. They've done all kinds of really cool experiments. Here's an example where they have three baby birds and they stick a popsicle stick and make a fake beak and they make it wider and redder than the actual baby birds. And the mother, this is a signal to feed the larger and redder beak. So the mother will feed this fake bird and let her own babies starve. Because this is called a supernormal stimuli. It's a stimuli that wasn't present in the ancestral environment, but is triggering behavior now. And you know where this is heading. So there was a famous experiment with thirsty monkeys where they attached headphones to the monkey and squirted some fruit juice unexpectedly after a tone was heard on the headphones. And they measured the dopamine neuron response of the monkeys. And dopamine is a neurotransmitter that's associated with reward and motivation. And when you have a burst of dopamine, you're like, whoa, that's great. Like when, well, I'll say that later. But when the monkeys then heard the tone again and again, and got the squirt of fruit juice, they got the same juice, but their dopamine response started to go down until after about five or six times, they heard the tone, they knew what was coming, there was more juice, there was no unexpected reward anymore, and the dopamine neurons went all the way back to the baseline. So it wasn't the juice that was motivating the monkeys, it was the unexpected reward. And so that is present in the human sphere as well. Parkinson's disease is when you don't have enough dopamine in one area of the brain. And so they give you a pill called Mirapex, and it boosts dopamine in all areas of the brain. What they found is Mayo Clinic, close to where I live, had hundreds of patients over years calling in with bizarro symptoms. A little old lady lost $200,000 gambling at casinos. She had never gambled in her life. A church pastor had like 15 extramarital affairs, and he had never had a girlfriend in his life. So more dopamine was leading to more consumptive behavior. This is impacting when we get habituated to more and more stimuli, which is in our world all the day with internet and Facebook and all these things. The neural ratchet hijacks us so that our decisions every day, a good decision and a bad decision, exercise or watch TV, salad or burger, save the climate or vacation, is when our brains are hijacked that way, the little decision trees kind of tilt downward until we end up making lots of these choices. Okay, cognitive biases. The whole problem with the world is that fools and fanatics are always so certain of themselves and wiser people so full of doubts. Confidence is adaptive. For us to think that we're better than we are, both in evolutionary time and right now, is helpful to us. 95% of college professors think they're better than average college professor at teaching and at getting along with people. There's all sorts of examples that thinking optimistically is healthy. Thinking optimistically suppresses cortisol, which is a stress hormone. It boosts helper T cells, which help the immune system. Thinking negatively is not healthy. So we are kind of biased to have a bias towards the positive. But we have enormous amounts of cognitive bias I'm going to skip that and keep going because I still have a lot of slides to come. So the brain is not like one thing that organizes itself and agrees. It's a bunch of different modules, kind of like a lunar module has all these things that allow it to work. The same thing with the brain. Whichever area of the brain is shouting the loudest kind of gets the vote at that moment. So it doesn't mean that we're rational or super aware of what we're doing. We just kind of respond in the moment. Now, I'm not going to delve much into microeconomics, but there are enormous amounts of biases built into our behavior. And I'm sure everyone in this room, a lot of you I know are concerned about climate change. And I'm sure those that are not concerned about climate change, that both of you know people in your life that believe the exact opposite. Or if you believe in God or not God, or belief in Ford versus Chevy, or all kinds of things, that people really, really believe in what they believe. And it's not adjusted by facts. It's hardly ever adjusted at all. And all of us have these beliefs that can't obviously all be true. So the odds are that probably most of us are wrong about a lot of things. But this is built into the human brain, and I would argue this is one of the smartest people on the planet, a physicist who is very concerned about climate change. His answer, we need to terraform Mars. So Stephen Hawking, is super brilliant about climate change and about other things, but he doesn't know that much about energy and resources to think that we actually could terraform Mars. So I've come to the conclusion that humans are delusional. And I don't mean that in a pejorative way necessarily. We need to kind of embrace delusionality. I'm delusional too. And I've noticed things, I think about it, and I notice when I'm cocksure about something and I ended up being wrong, I kind of quickly forget about that being wrong. But we're delusional. And I think we go through our day. Being delusional is helpful to our lives because it allows us to accomplish things. It allows us to be successful. It's being delusional about being delusional that is the problem. So getting close to the end of human behavior, it's not that we go through life saying, hey, how do I get my genes to the next generation? I think if I do this, I'll be able to have more children. No, what we're doing is the moment we're born, we were fitness maximizers all the way until the moment we were born. From the moment we're born, we're adaptation executors. We're executing adaptations that are in our brain. And how do we do that? The currency is hormones, neurotransmitters, the endocrine system, and we pursue feelings that our ancestors had. We get them in different ways today. And the problem with some of the things that the people in this room are concerned about is these very loudly shouting things shout much louder than these very, very important things. Okay, the environment. I'm not going to give this its due process because I think a lot of you already are fluent in climate change, but I do have a few important things. As you know, we passed 400 parts per million. We know the signature in CO2 is human in origin because of the chemical isotope signature. The green chart is the pH of the ocean, which is a logarithmic scale, and the ocean is already 30% more acidic than pre-industrial times. And depending on the source, this has never happened this fast in 20 million years, or you had said, some people say 200 million years. It's never happened this fast. This is a major problem. So this is the IPCC climate spectrum of impacts in Celsius for the next 100 years. The comment I would make here is that I, because of my work on energy and fossil fuels, I do not believe that we have the remaining affordable fossil fuels to reach the A1, F1, and A1B scenarios. That's my opinion. But that doesn't mean that there could be some coal bed fire in China that burns for 100 years that's not in the models. It doesn't mean that a lot of positive feedbacks, the feedbacks aren't even in the IPCC models. I don't know. I have a lot of climate scientist friends, and they are all between moderately and extremely scared. I think it's very important to note this top comment did not make it into the summary for policymakers, but did make it into an op-ed piece in Science last month, 2 months ago. A central finding of the new IPCC report is that the growth of income is the single largest driver of emissions. Well, you can imagine why that didn't make it into the summary for policymakers. And that's at the heart of some of the issues facing the Yukon as well. So another comment is most of the literature says what's going to happen to climate to 2100. There's very little of it that goes beyond 2100, as if the world stops being important in 2100. So I think we need to think on really long timelines, and the things that we care about and want to protect don't stop existing in 2100. So there's a website I'll send to Jill if any of you haven't seen it. It's called a SNAP. It's from Alaska. But there's all kinds of things that you can look with the 2 kilometer integrity in the Yukon. And just, I picked one example. I'm not sure that you can see it, but this is the baseline growing days from 1961 to 1990. And right around Whitehorse, it's like 123 to 147, somewhere in that range. Using midline, not the worst, not the best, but the middle of the road IPCC scenarios, this is the growing days in 75 years from now. And the growing days went from 147 to 220. So another 3 months of growing days in Whitehorse. That has major implications. So outside of climate and ocean acidification, we humans, depending on the boundaries, use between 25 and 40% of the net primary productivity, which the sun creates via photosynthesis on the entire planet. We are in the midst of the sixth great extinction, and the cause is us. We commonly see the world population graph that in the year 10,000 BC, there were 1 million people. As of last month, we're 7.3 billion people. But what we don't commonly see is this chart, which in 10,000 BC, animals outweighed, all the wild animals in the world outweighed humans 100 to 1. In the year 2000, the blue is our livestock for our food supply. The red is all the humans alive, the weight, and the green is wild animals. Now in 2014, humans and our livestock outweigh wild animals 50 to 1. That's another reason I'm here, because just the moose in your territory outweigh humans 50 to 1. Just the moose, not to mention the caribou and the sheep and the bears and everything else. This is a freaking special place. Okay. So what's an armadillo for? I was going to put some obscure Yukon animal, but then I figured someone would say, well, we eat it. So I asked my students this, what's an armadillo for? And they kind of like, they don't say anything for a minute, and then someone raises their hand and they say, you can make boots out of it? And an armadillo is for nothing. Armadillo for itself. It followed its own evolutionary trajectory. It's got its own series of things it goes through its life and does. It does not have to be something for human value. We don't have to look at everything from an anthropocentric lens. Okay, I'm going to go through this as a personal theory of mine. It's slightly speculative, but I fully believe it's true. So there's something called the fourth law of thermodynamics, which is the maximum power principle, which suggests that organisms and ecosystems self-organize so as to access and degrade available energy. So in a forest transect here, from a thermal scan, the coolest places will be the tops of the trees, because they're degrading sunlight. The hottest places will be the forest transect, the path, because there's nothing growing there. So humans used to band together and generate surplus for the hive back then, which was agricultural surplus. And what happened when Cortez found South America, he found the same palaces, the same irrigation ditches, the same politicians, the same priests, the same sort of buildings, the same sort of canals. And the two cultures had been separated for 15,000 years. And these things were able to grow the system larger so as to degrade energy and resources. So I would argue what I've said so far, that until the year 1970, we had an ecologically empty planet, relatively speaking, and we were growing by adding high quality, cheap energy to a system. And then that hit a speed bump in the 70s, and so we had to go to debt and globalization to keep access to the energy spigot. And then the whole system blew up in 2007, 2008. And then the central banks had to come to the rescue, and they had to do quantitative easing and too large to fail guarantees and all these things to keep access to the energy spigot. And now we're even changing the definition of GDP so as to still stay within the austerity requirements. Italy right now is including prostitution sales and cocaine sales in their GDP so that they don't fall below the EU requirement. Some of this is beyond our control. Okay, synthesizing everything so far. So in the long run, this is kind of not debatable. I don't know whether oil will peak in 5 years or in 50 years, but it will peak, and in the over a 10 or 20,000 year perspective, you know, this is where we are, where that red star is. So the human ecosystem in the past, in the present, and in the future is pretty simple. We take energy and natural resources and ecosystem services, we turn them into dollars or some financial marker, and we turn the dollars into feelings plus waste. And of course, the long-term challenge is how do we get those feelings while minimizing the energy and natural resources and minimizing the waste. So I don't know what the future is going to be. I think anyone that says they know, you kind of have to doubt, because there's too many variables. Every day I think about the future, and I have a normal distribution in my brain that assigns different probabilities. I think the probability of business as usual continuing is extremely low. But there's lots of other possibilities. I think that that growth is probably over for most developed countries. In fact, and again, I don't know the stats for Canada, but in the United States, 95%, which would be the bottom four lines, 95% of Americans have less salary after inflation than they did in 2002. So our systems need permanent support. We have artificially low interest rates. We have direct liquidity to major institutions, government deficit spending. Central bank is buying our debt. The government's buying its own debt, et cetera. All these are supposedly temporary measures. But if any one of those temporary measures goes away, we have an imploding system. So our economic pie, think about it, that the main ingredient is energy. Energy is the red. So as we get more costly energy, we can grow the economy, but the energy part of the economy is growing faster, so, and more expensive. So the benefits to the rest of us are not as much as they used to be. Also, what's happening is there's financial shenanigans at the top, the white, and the financial shenanigans coming in to support the system don't go equally to everyone. They largely go to the 5 or 10% that own shares and that are at the top. So I like to think of GDP, economic growth, as this iceberg. And the green line shows that we kind of have recessions, but we go higher. But the red line is uneconomic growth. It's oil spills and psychological counseling and prisons and things that and climate change and things that take away from the goods, their economic bads. Very quickly on renewables. We've built a civilization. The last 40 or 50 years, we've built our institutions, our policies on 4 to 5 cents a kilowatt hour electricity and $20 to $30 a barrel oil. And so to continue growth with all the financial claims that we have extant, we need an energy source of 4 or 5 cents a kilowatt hour. We have plenty of energy out there, renewable and non-renewable, that's 8, 9, 10, 12, 14 cents. But those things in aggregate will not be able to continue economic growth. And if not, then we have to prepare for the end of economic growth. So real quickly, the last 30 years, we have a lot of new technologies, renewables, et cetera, but the same amount of coal, oil, and natural gas in the world economies as there was. So one problem with humans is that when things go wrong, we tend to blame. We tend to blame others. We blame politicians, the tree huggers, the Chinese, the rich, the poor. And this is part of our evolutionary heritage when we lived in smaller tribes, is that we blame someone when things go wrong. It's called an in-group, out-group reaction. But the true blame is towards fossil slaves have been asking for a pay raise. Extraction costs have gone up 17% a year since 2002 for oil. And so I think it's important to know where the real blame lies. And we all have, you know, people and organizations and parties that we disagree with, but we're all kind of in it together. And this is the real driver. There are some other people at fault, of course, but this is the real driver. And another problem why we can't discuss these things is I can't go to, well, I have, but it's not well received, to major corporations or Washington, D.C. to talk about these things, because from their perspective, the things I'm saying would take society away from rich feeding grounds that are fossil fuels. So there is a status ceiling to what can be said. And if you say things that are above the status ceiling, you're ostracized. So there's a window of when real world events catch up to the things I'm saying, and you have to really quickly, you know, I'm sure many of you are nodding your head that you know talking about these things is a status risk. I'm gonna skip this for, okay, so what we've done in our current system, real quickly, is we've gone from resilience and redundancy towards efficiency and profit. We've exchanged time and labor for energy and money. We've exchanged time, labor, and resources for this novelty gadget dopamine treadmill. And we've replaced social and human capital with financial capital. And we've gone from local and regional economies to globalized economies. I would argue that we're about to head the other direction in all of those things. I think America is unlikely to lead the world into a degrowth scenario. I think 20 years after growth stops, we might step up and do something. Canada might, because people are a little more laid back here. They're a little bit more forward thinking. They're a little bit more environmentally conscious. There's a lot less population density, and you have a lot more natural capital. And I think there's possibilities. This is a graph showing primary energy capita per use, energy per human on the bottom scale, and percent very happy on the left. And it turns out the United States uses double the energy of the Netherlands, and it uses 38 times the energy of the average Filipino, yet the average Filipino is the same amount very happy as the average American. Once you have your basic needs met, you don't get a lot of additional satisfaction from more consumption. So there's also some other good news, is that the average American consumes 3,500 endosomatic within the body calories per day. That's what we eat. But our energy footprint is 235,000 calories a day, if you add up all the coal, oil, natural gas, and stuff. So we have like an 80-to-90-to-1 buffer on what our bodies need. So we're really not broke at all. Just the financial system has some problems, but there's plenty of energy. Okay, conclusions. Money is a marker for energy and real capital. For most people, growth is already over. There's no shortage of energy, but rather a longage of expectations. We're headed for a lower consumption, more local and regional future. Long-term risks like climate change are drowned out by near-term wants and needs. Some specific likely implications, in my opinion, for Yukon. The cost of getting things here is likely going to go up. Highly energy-intensive supply chains and products might become less affordable and available. There's going to be widening and deepening poverty when measured in dollars, I must add. Increasing volume and social angst as Northern Canada is in the crosshairs of energy and environmental battle. So what am I doing? I have been doing energy education to educate people on the importance of energy in our society. I'm working with Stanford University to put together a net energy protocol where corporations and governments can make decisions in energy terms instead of in dollar terms, using energy inputs. I'm working on talking to US foundations about how to shift their planning away from this towards something more like this, because I think social cohesion and dealing with growing poverty is gonna be a very near-term need. And I'm working on some long-term environmental projects on with the Bottleneck Foundation on what do we wanna propel, what do we aspire to as humans, what do we wanna propel forward in time. I also grow some of my own food. I grew too many potatoes last year, and I put on 25 pounds. And I'm just trying to be a better person generally. So what can you be doing? You all came here. So I would say that it would have been healthier for you all to not come tonight. But since you're here, I will offer some further suggestions. So I think we have three problems that overlap, but they're separate. We have the environmental problem, climate, ocean acidification, biodiversity, sixth great extinction, which is separate from the end of growth and resilience. How does Whitehorse be more resilient? How does it change what it's doing here in response to the end of growth? And then we have a psychological, ethical, moral thing encompassing all of this. Americans have 4.5% of the world's population. We have 50% of the toy sales. We use 25% of the oil. We have 50% of the pharmaceutical prescriptions. We have the highest gun ownership per capita in the world. These are problems that are not really related to environment and end of growth. So I'm going to talk about some things. We could talk globally, we could talk nationally or regionally. I'm going to talk mostly to you as individuals now because that's what I've been thinking about. And none of the things I'm going to suggest are necessarily answers, but they're things that I've thought a long time about that I think is going in the right direction. Okay, what to do? First, embrace life. This is my 11-year-old golden retriever, Quinn. And since he was six, he had these fatty tumors all over his body, like 50 of them. And my prior two golden retrievers died at six and at seven from cancer. So for the last 5 years, I've been perpetually worried that Quinn is going to die. And that worry has interfered with my enjoyment of my relationship with my dog. So the message here is, yes, there are some dire scenarios out there. There's financial collapse. There's runaway climate change. There's other problems. There's not a lot we can do about those, and our brains naturally tend to blow those out larger than they probably are. And so we just kind of have to assume those things are possible. I want to work towards things that I can do and enjoy my life and not burn out. And I think that's important. Okay, number two, assert control. There was a physiological study done on college students where they hooked people up to this machine where they turned a knob, and as the knob went higher, they had to punch the colors, blue, orange, purple, yellow, white. And then they kept turning the knob higher, and whoa, I can't do it. And then at the end, they interviewed the people, and they took a blood test. Well, the blood test showed that they had elevated cortisol, which is a stress hormone. And they were like, that was so hard, I was stressed, I didn't like that. But then they did the test again, where the students could control the knob themselves, the blue, purple, blah, blah, blah. And they actually turned the knob faster, further, and successfully did the task. They interviewed, they said, this is great, that was fun. And they did the blood test, the cortisol was normal. So the message there is when you assert control over a task or something in your own life, it's much healthier for you. And as opposed to reacting to what someone else tells you or you have to do something, when you assert control, that has impact. Okay, think in terms of real capital. So, you know, we like to say, oh, that guy's rich. He's loaded. Well, you know what? You people in the Yukon are really rich. And I think the measure of what we consider wealth has got to change. And you all here are so unbelievably lucky, I can't tell you. So in the Yukon, of course, financial markers are a marker for real capital, natural capital, social capital, built capital, and human capital. And I think if each of you start to kind of think of that way, I think that would at least be able to speak the same language, and I think that's important. Take back language. So this is a scene from the movie The Elephant Man, where John Merrick said, I am not an animal, I am a man. And I feel the same way in our society where I'm told that I'm a consumer. The consumers did such and such. I'm not a consumer. I'm a human, and I think we change the conversation when we change the language. Another example I'll give is everyone's familiar with fossil fuels. Well, it's really fossil carbon and fossil hydrocarbons that were under the ground. We decided to use them for fuels, and just like any magic that we've gotten, we've used two wishes from Aladdin's lamp, and we have one left, and it, you know, maybe even changing the name, the nomenclature to that fossil carbon in the ground instead of fossil fuels. Because if it's fuels, well, we got to burn it. Learn something new, learn something old. I don't know what the future's going to be. It's probably going to be a combination of technology and some old school stuff, but I think to continue to learn how to program computers or do high technology, but marry it with old skills that we're forgetting. I own some draft horses, and we're trying to learn how to do logging with them. Small machine repair, things like that, canning food, all those things are important. Wants versus needs, reflection. In a world where everyone thinks the blue line is going to manifest, maybe some things following the red line, it would be healthier if you, instead of trying to super have the most of everything, you just give something up at times or what. And so personal reflection of your own wants and needs, I think, is important. And if we look back at that chart where increasing incomes give you massive increases in utility and well-being until you reach a certain level, how many people truly need the flexibility and the energy to bake 2 turkeys at 3 a.m? We don't need that, yet we all have that ability. And again, on a related note, we have so many super normal things in our life that maybe we should try to go back to just the normal a little bit. And there's so many little dopamine triggers that pull us into, you know, when I open the fridge at 2 a.m, it's not because my body is starving, it's because I'm bored or I just want a feeling of eating something. And so I think we need to consciously go back up one notch in these decision trees. And one thing I'm trying to do more of, instead of sending a nice email, like when I leave here, instead of emailing Jill about my experience, I'm going to go home and I'm write her a letter. Because that is one example of just taking a step back in the other direction of slowing our brains down to more the pace that we evolved. Oh, I also like finding rocks. This is a 1-billion-year-old agate, and there's agates where I live. And that's how I get my dopamine. Getting rocks like that doesn't hurt anyone, except future rock pickers maybe. But so a lot of people get their dopamine from building another shopping center or things like that. We get the same brain chemicals, just a different output. Okay, 4:30, this I just came up with. We are delusional, and I suggest that once a day for 10 minutes, you consciously choose to be non-delusional. And 4:20 was already taken, so I just suggested 4:30. But you just, for 10 minutes, don't talk to anyone, don't read any emails, just think about the world, preferably in nature. Think about how all this stuff fits together, and try and see where we really are and how we, you know, it's kind of like an internal true north compass. Choose your tribe. So my tribe used to be guys in my cubicles next to me making 20 grand on a trade, giving high fives. And I didn't want any part of that. And I think a friend of mine told me that the trains that we're on right now are being, the conductors are sociopaths. And there's nothing we can really do about them. So you just have to kind of choose the right dining car with people you want to hang out with. And I think that's very instructive, because keeping the tribe close and having stories told keeps things in the fairway and allows us to accomplish something greater right around the corner. We need to keep that social capital going. And the task that we face is monumental, especially with climate change and with evaluating the future. And it's almost like Frodo and everyone taking the ring to Mordor. And so you might possibly think of the Fellowship of the Yukoners. That red X is supposed to be over there. But be pro-social. So a lot of people hear about these things, and they're like, oh, well, I'm just going to buy guns and gold because if stuff falls apart, I need to protect myself. That's just translating the problems into another type of similar problem. And I think especially in Whitehorse, where everyone kind of knows everyone and the richest person and the poorest person are still in a small town, I think you have a real opportunity to develop something that crosses political boundaries and crosses different belief boundaries here. I didn't have time to talk about this, but I'm very interested in this research. Selfishness beats altruism within groups. Altruistic groups beat selfish groups. So our evolutionary past, there's a lot of writing on how this transformed us as a species. Okay, die liking yourself is something that I've decided I want to do. And in order to die liking yourself, of course, unless you're very lucky, you need to live liking yourself. And given some of the depressing statistics I've shared with you tonight, it's difficult to figure out how to live in this environment. And I think it's very, very important that we pass the baton onto the future in some pro-social way that values natural capital and values other species and values future generations. And I've decided, I made a personal pledge with myself that I don't know how to do it yet, but I've agreed with myself that I will not accept dead oceans full of jellyfish and slime, dead ecosystems. And I don't know what I'm gonna do yet, but I've signed that contract with myself. And if you really care about things, maybe make a personal pact with yourself and don't go say, hey, Joe, I did the pact. It's not about anyone else. It's not about status. It's about your own relationship while you're on the planet and what you wanna do. And I think we have to somehow navigate the volume change between the things that shout for our immediate attention and the things that we know are wrong and that we really care about. And I think this is not going to take intelligence in the human sense. I think it's going to take more alien thinking, more ways of thinking that are not culturally acceptable, that are outside of the box. And I think we need warriors and mystics as much as we need people reducing their consumption by 20% or 30%, because that's not quite sufficient. And remember that our descendants are downstream from us. And so our impacts are impacting all of our descendants and their descendants. And so if we think about if the future is real, how many humans have ever lived? Well, there's 7 billion alive today. People think there's around 85 billion that have lived before us. So there's 90 billion humans have ever been on the planet. What if we aspire to have a trillion humans 100,000, 200,000, 300,000 years from now with meaningful lives and playful childhoods and libraries and things like that? We're snuffing them out kind of by our actions today. And I think a trillion humans is something that we can and should aspire to. And the Yukon is and could remain awesome. And as Yukoners, what would you be proud of to accomplish, even if it was really hard? Thank you.
Well, thank you, Nate. That was intense and a lot of information, and I think we're going to be going away thinking about that for quite a while yet. Thank you. And I'd really like to open the floor to questions just for a short while. I would like to say that we're recording this, so we'll be putting it up on a website. If you have anybody you know who'd like to watch it, we'll be able to send you a link. Thank you. And that means that we're going to take a microphone around to people who want to ask questions so that the questions can be heard on the video. So if you put up your hand, I'll pick you out. Okay, Amber will bring the microphone.
Okay. My question is, are you the kind of man your dog thinks you are?
My dogs love me, seriously. Yeah, I have a great relationship with my dogs. There was one picture in there that I had her under the covers and I was reading a book to her. We do that stuff all the time. I couldn't imagine life without a dog. And there's more dogs than... Really? Yeah. So, yes, I like dogs. I met your dog in the car. He's just got a puppy. Yes.
What was it Stephen Hawking said? Was it something about Mars?
Stephen Hawking, you know, brilliant man, but he's just who I chose as an example to be delusional. I could have picked anyone. But he is very knowledgeable about physics and natural science, but thinks that we can terraform. The answer to climate change is that we terraform Mars, that we move colonies to Mars so that we're not disrupting the Earth.
What's something you've been wrong about?
Something I've been wrong about is I was worried about natural gas in 2005 or 2006. Conventional production was starting to roll over, and I was uneducated at the time of unconventional natural gas and how much we could actually ramp up unconventional natural gas. I was also wrong about how much credit could allow the world economies to access a more expensive tranche of oil in the last 5 or 6 years. But I think that's a limited window still. I haven't been wrong about too much, but I am wrong about, been wrong about a lot of personal decisions, but yeah.
You've worked with people who have a lot of money and live in, you know, highly dense urban areas or whatever you want to call them. Do you think that having a type of tourism where you just drop these people on their own lake in the middle of the Yukon wilderness for a day or 2 days or whatever might wake them up to the importance of preserving things like that?
Honestly, that's another reason I'm here, is because the things that I shared with you tonight, if I was in downtown Montreal or Ottawa, these things, some people might resonate with them. But the fact that you have a lot of poor people here, the fact that the natural capital is right here and you live it every day, the fact that you're kind of at the end of the supply chain and you know that energy is important, all those things you already intuit, you already experience yourselves. So I personally think that the people at the top will be the absolute last to understand the things that I've talked about. Because, first of all, they wouldn't have gotten to be so successful and rich if they cared about these things. And again, I have no real complaints with Wall Street rich people, because there are doctors and lawyers and real estate developers and dentists who are also sociopaths. It's not just Wall Street. But we get, it's like a lion has a thorn in its paw, and these people are just raging around thinking that what they're doing is the best thing when it's really not. And so we kind of need to pull that thorn out somehow, and then the lion will be a nice guy and help us. Yeah, I don't know the answer to that. I think most of them wouldn't do that. It would be too scary. In my state, there are people that shoot trophy deer and have the things mounted, they paid $500 for them, and they sell them to the rich businessmen in Illinois for $10,000, who can hang it up in his wallet and say, yeah, I went up to Wisconsin and shot a big deer. It's like a big business. Yeah, so it's, you know, male egos are a big part of the problem worldwide, have always been, truthfully. Yes? Oh,
Peter,
I'm sorry.
Just
I'm sorry.
Oh,
I'm not. I'm not in control.
Is there any hope for Americans?
Well, I think when you ask questions like "What's the answer?" or "Is there hope?" or I think we have to look at the perspective from your, you know. Is there hope for the next 5 years? Is there hope for the next 500 years? Is there hope for the Yukon? Is there hope for Canada? I mean, what does hope mean? I mean, it always depends on the perspective of the question. I'm very worried about America, not so much because of energy, but because the end of growth means that someone that was making $45,000 a year with three kids now is going to be making $41,000 with three kids, and things are more costly. And that person is going to be angry and blame the wrong people and be disruptive. And so there's this social cohesion issue that I'm mostly concerned about Americans. Why Americans? Because we're spoiled frickin' rotten. Canadians too, less so. But we're all fantastically rich, and we don't even realize it. We want to be richer. And we talk about population, 7.3 billion people. That's a problem. It's not the biggest problem. The biggest problem, while those people are consuming enormous amounts, that's not the biggest problem. The biggest problem is that America and Canada are marketing to all the rest of the world, this is what you should aspire to do. That's the biggest problem. So I think Canada, maybe the Yukon, could change that message. And how cool would it be, and I don't have specific ideas on this, but I will think about them. How cool would it be if the Yukon changed in a way, because of your low population and the other things I mentioned, that you did some things that a German and an African and a Chinese found out about and said, holy crap, look what they did, isn't that cool? I mean, I'm dreaming, so.
Okay, should we take one more question? Thanks.
Yeah, your lenses were really interesting. Great presentation. On the behavior lens, I think we just started a really strong initiative here in terms of actually asserting political control from the grassroots with community rights charters. One just little point on the slide with the peak oil.
Yeah.
You know, it's in the future. We don't know when it is. And you have another slide where you or slides where you talk about net energy.
Yeah.
Give or take, it kind of peaked about a generation ago.
Net energy.
Yeah, but that's the interesting part is that all your other information, in terms of finance, in terms of economic decline, they actually align with the net energy peak oil, not with the peak oil idea. So the real relevant peak oil is the net energy peak oil, which is a generation in the past. I mean, when I started talking years ago here to political leaders about it, and they said, no, you're wrong. You know, it's all status quo. It's like it was before there was a net energy peak oil. That's just so it's sort of just the context is what I. There's a context between the net energy peak oil and the peak oil slide is sort of a little bit isolated in its information.
So I didn't want to get too deep into net energy because it gets a little confusing, but basically what he's saying is that after we subtract the energy cost of getting the energy, that the amount of energy left, that amount has peaked a long time ago. I don't fully agree with that because we've made up for it with scale, but what we're doing now is the negative benefits that we're getting from this expensive oil and from oil's peaking are being temporarily papered over by the creation of money. Money cannot create energy. Money can extract energy faster. So we're on this treadmill and we're throwing money into it to make it look like it's not as bad as it is. But yes, it's taking a lot more energy to get energy than it used to. But I don't know the exact dates on those things.
Okay, well, thank you for the questions, everybody. I think that we will conclude today, and if anybody wants to come up afterwards and talk to Nate, I think he would be happy just to spend some more minutes here. First of all, I just really want to thank Nate for coming all this way. It took several conversations to persuade him because, of course, we had the conversation about all the fossil hydrocarbons it was going to take to get him here. And I really want to thank you for coming, Nate, taking this time. I know how busy you are with all the really important things you're doing. And I feel really privileged that we've been able to hear all this today. And I hope that we can, moving forward, as we have more of these presentations, we can have some group discussions about what we're going to do and what we really, because that's what it takes. We've got to do something. Like Nate was saying, what he's doing personally, we've all got to do something. So thank you to everybody for coming out tonight. And I'd just like to present Nate with, he was asking me for a Protect the Peel sticker and what that was. So I'm just going to give him a Protect the Peel t-shirt here.
Double XL, I hope.
It's a big one. I don't know if it's big enough. And then here is a CD about the Peel Watershed, which was released about 10 days ago by Matthew Leon. And that's some music composed in the Peel Watershed. So thank you, Nate. Thank you.